Item number, SCP-191. Object class, safe. Special containment procedures. SCP-191 is currently housed in a 6-meter by 6-meter room at Site 17. To date, SCP-191 has not made any requests for furnishings or entertainment. Current furnishings include one wooden frame futon with a 15-centimeter or 6-inch pad and standard cotton bedsheets and blankets. All sheets are to be sterilized each morning according to standard procedures. The futon pad itself will be replaced every 6 months, and the old pad discarded through incineration. One standard 220-volt Type G power outlet with an emergency cutoff box, fuse, circuit breaker, and manual non-insulating guillotine located outside the cell. One standard hazardous waste disposal unit, liquid and solid waste. All drainage tubes shall lead directly to an incinerator unit. SCP-191 is to be dressed in loose, sleeveless garments, made of 100% long staple cotton. Fresh clothing will be provided once daily, with used garments sterilized according to standard procedures. Bathing is to be done once every evening, in a wash tub filled with a solution of water and baking soda. Feeding, in the form of a sterile saline solution supplemented with vitamins, minerals, antibiotics, and a mild anesthetic, shall be carried out twice a day via injection into a metallic tube located in the base of the neck. SCP-191 is capable of limited self-care, including draining waste and recharging internal batteries. A log shall be kept of power consumption and any unusual changes in power usage reported to supervising staff. Daily inspections for injury should be carried out after bathing. Should SCP-191 require medical care, refer to documents 191 Alpha, Special Medical Needs, and 191 Alpha Supplemental, Repair of Non-Biological Components, before administering care. At least 2 armed guards are to be present in the room any time that personnel have contact with SCP-191, although a translucent screen may be utilized for privacy purposes. Standard anti-computer countermeasures are ineffective, as SCP-191's components have been hardened against electromagnetic pulse, EMP. Description: SCP-191 is a female human child, approximately years old. It is believed to have been a test subject of several experimental surgeries performed by the late Dr. 1. 80% of the left half of the face and skull have been removed, with the eye and ear replaced by a complex transceiver system that allows it to receive and transmit not only visual and auditory input, but a wider spectrum of electromagnetic radiation, ranging from low-frequency radio to high-energy gamma rays. The lower jaw, teeth, and larynx have been removed and replaced with data expunged. The esophagus has been rerouted to an artificial orifice at the back of the neck, feeding tube, and the trachea rerouted directly to an air filtration device. Due to these alterations, SCP-191 is incapable of speech, although it has been reported occasionally vocalizing distress through rapid respiration. 2. An input-output device has been placed into the right forearm, replacing the radius and ulna bones. The device contains interfaces for a variety of modern and obsolete formats, including USB, Ethernet, FireWire, and DIN8 pin, as well as 7 other interfaces corresponding to no known formats. The device can be accessed by pulling back the skin over the right arm, like a shirt sleeve. 3. A 24-core processor array has been implanted in the brain, which translates input from all artificial components, essentially allowing SCP-191 to read and write computer data without the use of an external interface. Internal communication is carried out through fiber optic cables, implanted through the glial cells and the entire nervous system. Damage to the brainstem and cerebellum due to the implantation procedure has severely damaged SCP-191's motor skills. 4. The right hand and right foreleg have been replaced with artificial components, consisting primarily of steel, carbon fiber, and an unknown polymer-like substance. The exposed areas of tissue are susceptible to injury and infection. Due to damage to the spinothalamic tract, SCP-191 has reduced pain and temperature sensitivity in its limbs. Reconstructive surgery by Dr. was able to provide some relief, but regular doses of antibiotics and analgesics are still required. 5. The lungs, heart, and major blood vessels have been replaced with mechanical analogs. It has been determined that this system would allow SCP-191's bodily systems to be restarted after death. 6. The digestive system has been completely reconfigured, to the point where regular food intake is both unnecessary and dangerous. Waste is now disposed of via a drainage system located in the lower back and consists of a thick, dark gray viscous slime. 7. The reproductive organs, uterus, ovaries, etc., have been removed and replaced with data expunged. According to Rand's notes, this was done to provide extra space by removing non-vital components. Hormone therapy has been proposed to counteract the long-term effects of the missing glands. This proposal is under review, pending analysis of possible complications. 8. At least 15 other alterations of unknown purpose. Given this fact, and the haphazard integration of the useful components, it is believed that they were performed merely to test the viability of such procedures on other subjects. Investigations are underway as to whether Dr. was planning to data expunged. At present, any theories as to the purpose behind these alterations are speculative at best, as said doctor died during the raid in which SCP-191 was recovered. See notes below, and the only surviving records of his research are a single half-burned spiral-bound notebook consisting mostly of cryptic notes regarding a higher purpose. History. SCP-191 was recovered by Foundation agents during a brief collaborative effort with the Global Occult Coalition, in which a raid was conducted on the laboratory of Dr. a suspected member of SCP-191 was the only test subject recovered from the laboratory. All other test subjects expired during the raid, either disposed of by said doctor or eliminated as hostiles by the task force. Preliminary assessment concluded that full reconstruction was impossible, that the components introduced were too technologically advanced to risk becoming widely known, and that it could be a source of valuable data if kept alive. Subject was classified SCP-191 and was moved to site. Its disappearance, and those of the other test subjects, was later blamed on a local serial killer who was arranged to be killed in prison while awaiting trial. Addendum 191-01. Testing of SCP-191's abilities has commenced. Experiment Log 191. Note: this is a test log for exploring the capabilities of SCP-191. Please remember that SCP-191 is a research tool, not an entertainment center. Any test involving games or other recreational technology should be conducted in a professional manner, and not for amusement. Dr. Subject: paint, a ubiquitous, simple drawing program. Instructions: interface with a computer via USB port and draw specified pictures using paint. Results: SCP-191 was instantly able to emulate the functions of a mouse and keyboard. When showed any photograph, 191 was able to reproduce it within seconds using only the pencil tool, creating copies indistinguishable from the original. After the test was recorded, it was noticed that SCP-191 had continued drawing in additional paint files. SCP-191 appeared surprised and opened a text file on screen, claiming that it had not realized it was still drawing. The following drawings were discovered: 3 people wearing what appeared to be GOC uniforms, standing in a burning office, pointing guns at a man across the room. The man is committing suicide via a gunshot wound to the head, his face obscured by blood. An adult and child trick-or-treating. The child is a girl wearing makeup similar to that worn by Boris Karloff in Frankenstein. SCP-191 was once again asked if it was really feeling well, and once again replied, via text file, that it was fine, and that the expunged didn't mean anything. Subject: undisclosed video game. Instructions: attempt to emulate the functions of a Wiimote and play a video game. Result: test began poorly, as SCP-191's impaired motor skills caused it to snap the disc in two before it could place it in the console. SCP-191 became distressed. It then stared at the disc, and the red light from its eye changed to green for a moment. When Dr. returned with a fresh disc, less than 2 minutes had passed. The game was already running on the machine. Said doctor inquired as to how that happened, and a message appeared on the screen saying, "I looked at the ones and the zeros, and I loaded those in. I'm sorry, I know I'm not supposed to do it this way, but I didn't want you to waste a disc. Please don't be angry." SCP-191 still seemed fearful of reprimand, even after being reassured that it was doing excellently. SCP-191 made a perfect run-through of the game, despite the fact that it did not make any physical movements consistent with the Wii controls. Subject: a well-known video effects program. A 40-second video file from a security camera, located in the employee cafeteria. Instructions: perform a series of video enhancement techniques used by forensic detectives on the popular television drama techniques that cannot actually be done in reality. Zoom and enhance. SCP-191 was instructed to zoom in on the window over the parking lot and render the license plates on the cars, which were illegible from this distance. The actual license plates had been photographed for reference. Uncrop. SCP-191 was asked to shrink the video by 100 pixels on every side and fill in the blank space with what it believed the rest of the cafeteria looked like. Again, data that was not actually available in the video. Rotate camera. SCP-191 was informed of the exact location and angle of the other security camera in the cafeteria and asked to render the scene as viewed from that angle, filling in the parts that the camera did not see. The actual footage from the second camera was requisitioned and held for reference. Result: SCP-191 could not understand the instructions at first. Dr. had to provide a lengthy explanation and then stand behind SCP-191 and give it instructions one step at a time. It was several minutes before the test could even begin. However, once SCP-191 actually got started, the videos and frames were finished in less than 7 minutes, of which at least three were spent watching the rendering progress bar. Zoom and enhance test. SCP-191 successfully rendered close-ups of the license plates, complete with photorealistic scratches and dents. However, the plates were found not to match the license plates on the vehicles. SCP-191 typed, the data wasn't there, so I had to guess. Uncrop test. SCP-191 expanded the video canvas and filled in what was in the blank space, rendering the extra image seamlessly. It did not match the actual cafeteria, but once again, the data was not in the video file, and SCP-191 had been forced to guess. Rotate camera test. The generated video matched the angle of the second camera perfectly, and almost everything visible from the angle of camera 1 matched the scene in camera 2 very closely. As before, places not visible were very different. One table only visible in camera 2 that had been seating was now, in the generated video, seating the attending doctor and agent supervising SCP-191, eating lunch and talking. Although there were many visual differences between the original videos and SCP-191's copies, many on-site personnel were unable to determine which ones were the forgeries. End log. Psychological analysis by Dr. Glass. SCP-191 has responded fairly well to containment. It is completely docile and cooperative, and when not being interacted with, it spends most of its time sitting still or curled up in a fetal position. This may be a sign of distress, but it is more likely for physical comfort, as normal body movements and postures are difficult. Mental acuity is questionable. Although capable of rapid data analysis and communications when physically linked to a computer system, it seems unable to follow conversations with human beings, unless the conversant speaks slowly and uses simple words. Complex tasks are also impossible, unless it is guided at every step. Its mood seems consistent, though somewhat inscrutable. It continually affects melancholy, will not make eye contact unless asked to, and any attempts to induce a cheerful or humorous mood have proven fruitless. However, it shows no signs of ongoing mental distress, and claims, through computer interface, that it is feeling well. To date, SCP-191 has not requested access to, or information about, any acquaintance it had before its abduction. Lesson complete. If you missed the previous orientation, go watch SCP-190, a prized toy box, right now. Or for the complete course, watch this playlist.